A woman remembers a daughter. Ships appear peacefully and inexplicably in orbit. You already know how this story, how everything ends. At the turn of the 20th century, mysterious craft appear over Earth. The government says nothing about them, but in secret, recruits Dr. Louise Banks and Dr. Gary Donnelly, a linguist and physicist respectively, to help the United States communicate during this first contact. Today, we will be discussing The Story of Your Life, a phenomenal short story by Ted Chiang, which has been adapted into the excellent movie Arrival. The Story of Your Life is probably my favorite science fiction short story. It's incredibly intelligent and philosophical and touching, especially as a new father. So, if you haven't yet read The Story of Your Life, maybe consider it before we continue. I will include an Amazon link down in the description. Also, for today's video, I will be including footage from Arrival. Now, as you'll note, there are some major differences in the story between the novel and the movie, although it's certainly better than nothing. So, as mysterious craft appear over Earth, the United States, and presumably the rest of the world, is trying to figure out the intention of these new visitors, while also trying to figure out whether communication will even be possible. Dr. Louise Banks, as I alluded to, is a linguist specifically tasked with learning the native language of the aliens, and at first, she is given only samples by the US military, but when she explains that because of the likely anatomical differences in how the aliens produce speech, she convinces Colonel Weber of the US military that a face-to-face meeting, or at least an approximation of such, will be necessary. The military, however, is worried about security, including the fact that the aliens may already know human language, and have a vested interest in minimizing the amount of information and technology that is shared from humanity. So, communications with the beings is done through looking glasses, which the aliens have supplied, devices which allow communication with presumably the ships in orbit. 9 looking glasses are deposited in the United States, with 112 total throughout the world. The aliens are described as, and I quote, a barrel suspended at the intersection of 7 limbs, radially symmetric. Gary called them hedopods. The limbs had no distinct joints. Anatomists guess they might be supported by vertebral columns. 7 lidless eyes ringed the top of the hedopod's body. Louise and Gary interact with 2 hedopods, which speak through a fluttering sound, which can be read on spectrographs, but which is difficult, but maybe not impossible, for humans to recreate. The hedopod writing, however, was logographic, i.e. it used logos and images as whole words. At least that's how they see it at the beginning. And while Louise is able to identify a logical pattern to the hedopod's speech, the writing is completely, well, alien to those used by human societies. Louise learns that hedopods can integrate seemingly as many words as they want into a single logogram, though with additional complexity. For example, there's an image for hedopod and walk and ground, but there's also one image for hedopod walks on the ground, or hedopod walks on the ground on Earth when it's 300 degrees. The writing, if you can call it that, is also seemingly without any real order. All of the elements were combined basically organically. Here's another quote. Our biggest source of confusion was the hedopod's writing. It didn't appear to be writing at all. It looked more like a bunch of intricate graphic designs. The logograms weren't arranged in rows or a spiral or any linear fashion. Instead, Flapper or Raspberry would write a sentence by sticking together as many logograms as needed into a giant conglomeration. Louise continues to study as she recalls vivid memories of her daughter, her daughter's birth, her daughter's adolescence, and her daughter's tragic death at 25 years old. The team learns more and more about the hedopod written language, including the fact that it seems to be completely separate from their spoken language, and seems to serve a different purpose. The team refers to it as Hedopod B, and as their communication deepens, so too does the strangeness of Hedopod B. If I wasn't trying to decipher it, the writing looked like a fanciful praying mantis drawn in a cursive style, all clinging to each other to form an Escher-esque lattice, each slightly different in its stance, and the biggest sentences had an effect similar to that of psychedelic posters, sometimes eye-watering, sometimes hypnotic. Unfortunately, while progress was being made on communication, there was limited progress in the fields of mathematics or science. The Hetapods simply claimed that they came to observe humanity, and Louise actually begins to learn how to write the language, though at the beginning only when closing her eyes. Eventually, a foundational scientific breakthrough is reached on the basic of Fermat's principle, the principle of least time, that the path taken by light between two points will always follow the path that will be the fastest. Now, think about that for a while, because there's some weirdness there. And it turns out that Hetapod physics is fundamentally different. While they can understand least action principles and associated topics, they struggle with other, what we would consider to be, very basic mathematics. And this represents a fundamental difference in the way that Hetapods think. The process of Hetapod writing also represented that same differing understanding of the universe. Extremely complex sentences in Hetapod B were begun with seemingly random words, meaning that the Hetapod not only understood the beginning and the ending of the sentence before writing even the first stroke, but created incredibly intricate designs discussing things like hard science through these seemingly random strokes. Instead of constructing these sentences and these ideas and these stories bit by bit or sequentially as we would, they create the whole thing as a whole. Let's return to Fermat's principle, which again says that light, when traveling through space and matter, will take the path of least time. Because I think some of you are probably getting an idea of how Hetapods think compared to us, and here's a good quote from the book. Fermat's principle sounds weird because it describes light's behavior in goal-oriented terms. It sounds like a commandment to a light beam. Thou shalt minimize or maximize the time taken to reach thy destination. You're used to thinking of a reaction in terms of cause and effect. Reaching the water's surface is the cause, and the change in direction is the effect. The light can't start traveling in any old direction and make course corrections later on, because the path resulting from such behavior wouldn't be the fastest possible one. The light has to do all its computations at the very beginning. I thought to myself, the ray of light has to know where we'll ultimately end up before it can choose the direction to begin moving in. I know what that reminded me of. I looked up at Gary. That was what was bugging me. Louise is undergoing fundamental changes in the way she's thinking as her understanding of the alien language improves. She could start writing these alien pictures, but only if she doesn't consciously think about the sentence before writing. She finds if she can put down strokes without thinking, that it will be compatible even with complex sentences and ideas. Louise's change is moving her away from humanity and the way we see the world and time as causal. One thing causes another, to the Fermat-style variation principle like the Hetapods, a teleological understanding of the universe, where the whole purpose and the end of a thing is used to understand a system. Louise is beginning to see time like the Hetapods, the future and the present as one. The difference between humanity's sequential and the Hetapods' teleological understanding of the universe is summed up by another great quote from the short story. When the ancestors of humanity and Hetapods first acquired the spark of consciousness, they both perceived the same physical world, but they parsed their perceptions differently. The worldviews that ultimately arose were the results of this divergent gene. Humans had developed a sequential mode of awareness, while Hetapods had developed a simultaneous mode of awareness. We experience events in an order and perceive their relationship as cause and effect. They experienced all events at once and perceived a purpose underlying them all, a minimizing, maximizing purpose. And as a reader, we are now given the truth, the child that Louise has loved and lost, the one in which she has built her life around, which has died and which has shaped her life, has not yet been conceived. We see Louise buy a bowl, which she knows will eventually break, following an instinct which seems ingrained and natural. Still, while learning the language has given Louise an understanding of Hetapod consciousness, she still generally maintains that human way of thinking, that sequential view of reality. However, sometimes she sees the future and the past as memories, and occasionally she glimpses the world totally through the Hetapod language. She, and I quote, experiences past and future all at once. My consciousness becomes a half-century-long ember burning outside time. I perceive during those glimpses that entire epoch as a simultaneity. It is a period encompassing the rest of my life and the entirety of yours. Then the aliens leave, without warning, without celebration, without anything. They leave Earth, never to reappear. Working with the Hetapods changed my life. I met your father and learned Hetapod B, both of which make it possible for me to know you now, here on the patio in the moonlight. Eventually, many years from now, I'll be without your your father, and without you, all I will have left from this moment is the Hedipod language, so I pay close attention and note every detail. From the beginning, I knew my destination, and I chose my route accordingly, but am I working to an extreme of joy or of pain? Will I achieve a minimum or a maximum? These questions are on my mind when your father asks me, "Do you want to have a baby?" And I smile and answer yes. And I unwrap his arms from around me, and we hold hands as we walk inside to make love. To make you. This story deals with determinism and free will. The Book of Ages paradox, as described in the story, is the existence of a book which purports to tell an individual's future impossible because any individual who reads it will change that future. In the end, there is no simple way to boil this down to free will or determinism. Both are simply representative of the way Hedipods and humanity see the universe and see themselves. The Hedipods see themselves acting to create the future. Their method of thinking is incompatible, thus, with an understanding of free will. And as Louise learns her future, it is impossible for her to act against it. All actions are a way to bring the future into reality. But does that mean life loses all meaning? Well, not to Louise. The story is more than just an ending. It's the beauty of a journey, even when you already know the ending, when you already know what happens, when you know the pain. Even though Louise knows that her child will die and that there's nothing she can do to stop it, she finds incomparable joy as a parent in the day-to-day moments. There's a lot of nuance in here, and it really gets into the weeds of reality and fate. Maybe it's one that's borne out by free will, which has already happened and which we now understand, or maybe the universe always just had some sort of plan. For both species, though, it doesn't matter because humans are locked in their way of thinking and Hedipods are locked in their way. It's only the bridges between the two methods of consciousness, the Fermat's principle and the writing method, which truly allow humans like Louise to think about the nature of reality as it actually exists outside of her narrow viewpoint. And I wonder too whether the Heptapods actually gained anything from meeting humanity. All in all, though, this is a phenomenal book, and the movie is also really good. I think it does dial back on some of this a little bit. It almost treats certain elements of Louise's new consciousness as like a form of time travel, and I think the idea that the aliens came to Earth, that we could help them in the future, sort of misses the point. And I also think that it really gives away the twist of the child not being born yet far too easily. It's much more enjoyable in this book where we actually get to discover that the child has not been born and will die through Louise's experience rather than the aliens just telling her. But that's all I have for you guys. Hope you enjoyed this video. I hope this sparked some imagination in you as it did for me. Let me know what you thought about this. Let me know what you think about Ted Chiang's comments on reality and consciousness, and let me know if there's any stories you'd like me to cover in the future. That's all I have for you guys today, though. Until next time, have a good one, be safe, as if you have any choice, and may the Force be with you.